this program, we're going to discuss the sources of radiation commonly found in hospitals, the effects that can be caused by exposure to these sources, and the radiation protection practices that we need to use in order to reduce radiation exposures. The use of radiation for medical purposes really started at the end of the last century when a German scientist named Wilhelm Röntgen discovered a type of ray that could actually penetrate through solid objects and expose photographic film. He noted that flesh was transparent to the rays and bone was more opaque. And he announced his discovery to the world by sending x-ray pictures, like this one of his wife's hand, to the leading scientists in Europe. Just days after the news of Röntgen's discovery reached the United States, hospitals were using x-rays, like this one, taken in February 1896, that clearly shows embedded shotgun pellets in the hand of an individual involved in a hunting accident. During that same year, it was discovered that uranium gave off penetrating X-ray-like radiations, and Madame Curie, a French scientist, coined the word radioactive to describe that property of continuously emitting those particles and rays. Now, in terms of the potentially harmful effects of radiation, very early on, within months after the discovery of X-rays, scientists began to recognize that excessive exposures could cause some damaging effects. It often caused reddening and blistering of the skin. This damaging effect was soon put to use in treating cancers. And it wasn't long before the medical community recognized that repeated exposures to X-rays could be harmful to the doctors, the nurses, and the technicians that operated these machines. So we were aware of the potentially harmful effects of external exposures before the turn of the century. However, at that time, it wasn't appreciated that radioactive materials could be a hazard if taken internally into the body. Of course, there weren't very many radioactive materials in those early days, so it wasn't much of an issue. But with the identification of radium, a whole industry emerged, the luminizing industry. Radium was used as a source to excite fluorescent material and could be put into a paint. And you could paint on any object at all that you wanted to glow in the dark. In later years, the early dial painters were shown to have an increased incidence of cancer. You know, it's sort of ironic that from the radium dial painters' experience, we seem to remember the myth radiation can make a glow in the dark, and we tend to lose sight of the main lesson that it taught us. Small amounts of radioactive materials need to be controlled so they don't accidentally get into the body. So today, we classify radiation as external, that is, penetrating radiation where the source is outside the body, and internal, when the source actually gets into the body and radiates from within. Okay, we should also spend a few minutes discussing how radiation is measured, where it's found, and what biological effects it can cause. Ionization is what makes X-rays, gamma rays, and the particles emitted by radioactive materials unique. By unique, we mean that they have that special property of being able to strip electrons away from atoms and thereby form ion pairs. As a result of this process, the atom no longer bonds in molecules the way it's supposed to. And it's these molecular changes in human tissue that are at the root of all the biological effects that we observe. In radiation protection, we use a term that combines both biological factors and physical factors together into one unit that we call the REM. That's an expression of the amount of biological damage we would expect the ionizing radiation to do to the individual who's been exposed. We always express occupational doses in units of REM, so that's an important term for us to understand. The problem with using the REM as a unit of measure is that it's too large. The average hospital worker in the United States, for example, in a whole year receives about 0.15 REM, or 1/15 of one REM. And of course, a month's exposure is a lot smaller than that. So we use the prefix milli, meaning 1/1000 of, and insert it in front of the unit REM, and then our minds can work in whole numbers. Now we can say that the average hospital worker receives about 150 millirem per year. Okay. Now we know a little something about the history of radiation in the workplace and the basic units of measure. So where's radiation found? It's everywhere. It's not just found in hospitals. everyone who lives in the world is exposed to ionizing radiation regardless of their occupation. Now, individuals who routinely work around radiation sources get more. We call that added radiation their occupational dose. But just for a minute, let's focus on the amount of natural background radiation that everyone in the United States receives, where it comes from, and what the various levels are. Natural background radiation is due primarily to four components. The first is cosmic rays from outer space, the rays that continually bombard our atmosphere, eventually make it down to the Earth's surface and expose us. A second source of natural exposure is from radioactive materials in the Earth's crust, principally the isotopes of uranium, thorium, and potassium. These radioactive materials have been around since the solar system was formed and are not the result of radioactive waste, weapons testing, or nuclear power plants. In addition, there are small amounts of radioactivity within our own bodies. If we look at these first three components of natural background radiation and say, how much? It comes to about 100 milligrams per year for the average citizen in the United States. Some areas have half as much and some have twice as much, but 100 milligrams is the average. So ionization is neither new nor at normal background levels anything to get worried about. In addition, we have a fourth component of natural background radiation, which is caused by radon, which of course has become a frontline topic of interest today. Radon bubbles up from the Earth. We breathe it in and out all of the time. It is continually being produced as the uranium in the Earth decays. But unlike other sources that are natural, radon concentrations vary greatly from one location to another, and in a much more unpredictable way than the other components of natural background radiation. It's interesting when you look at some of the latest test results. Some of the highest measured radon concentrations have been found in buildings that were located in geographical areas where the average radon concentrations are the lowest. It's that kind of a thing. It may be very high on this side of the street and literally a small fraction of that on the other side. So the concentration of radon in the air that we breathe varies significantly, and energy conservation techniques like improved insulation and weather stripping tend to trap and increase those radon concentrations. The average annual effective radon dose to the population of the United States is 200 millirem per year. These four components of natural background radiation comprise 82% of the total annual radiation that each of us receives. The balance, the other 18%, are in an exposure category that we call man-made. The man-made category includes medical x-rays and nuclear medicine, which are the two biggest components of man-made exposure. But it's important to keep in mind that we're not talking about occupational exposures here. This 15% is the sum of all the nuclear medicine and medical x-ray procedures performed annually in the United States. So we're not addressing workers in hospitals yet, just the patients who are exposed. Finally, we have a small category of consumer products. Then, an even smaller category that contains all of our occupational exposures, the exposures from nuclear weapons testing fallout, and releases of radioactive materials from the nuclear power industry. Indeed, this is a very small slice of the pie that seems to get a very big slice of our attention, particularly in the media. If you look at the whole pie, it says that the average person in the U.S. receives 360 millirem per year. That's about 1 milligram per day. Okay, now that we understand some of the terminology and exposure levels that everyone receives, let's get down to the key question for hospital radiation workers. What are the risks in terms of biological effects associated with occupational levels of exposure? Well, there are essentially four separate categories of biological risks. The first effect is the one that comes to mind when we think of annihilation of the human race in thermonuclear war. And that's the prompt effects of acute radiation sickness. Prompt effects occur in the exposed individual soon after exposure to very large doses of radiation. If the exposure is high enough, there's damage to the blood-forming organs, the lining of the intestines, even the brain. So if the radiation dose is high enough in the range of hundreds of rem, that's hundreds of thousands of millirem, the outcome can be fatal. The important thing to remember here is that these types of prompt effects occur only at doses far above our regulatory limits. Acute radiation sickness is not a concern for hospital radiation workers. The second type of biological effect is what we call delayed effects. Delayed effects are those effects that may occur in the exposed individual years after exposure to radiation. The principal delayed effect is cancer induction. Well, what about occupational exposures? What can we say for sure about the delayed biological effect, the induction of cancer, as it relates to hospital workers? Not much, because we can't link a particular cancer with any occupational radiation exposure. The problem is that cancers caused by radiation exposures are no different from cancers that normally occur in our population. And the startling fact is that the frequency of cancer is very high. The risk that each of us runs of contracting some form of cancer in our lifetime is one chance in three. Every individual in the United States has about a 33% chance of contracting cancer at some point, and about half of those cancers, 16%, will be fatal. Kind of grim statistics, but very relevant. Cancer is a common disease, and there's no specific indicator or sign that says this cancer was caused by radiation. Physicians can't distinguish between radiation-induced cancer and naturally occurring cancers. We have some good data on individuals exposed to very high doses of radiation received in a short period of time, such as the survivors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. There is a statistical increase in the number of cancer deaths. What gets controversial is when this data is projected to estimate the increase in cancer deaths of those exposed to low doses of radiation. Here's how the projections are done using a graph which compares lifetime radiation dose in REM with the anticipated increase in the probability of cancer death over a lifetime. First, the increase in fatal cancers observed in groups exposed to high dose levels is plotted. This response pattern shows a greater increase in cancer death at higher doses. For a 200 rem dose, we would expect a 2% increase. For a 100 rem total lifetime radiation dose, we would expect just an additional 1% increase in the probability of cancer death. Here's the problem. For our average hospital occupational levels of 150 millirem per year, that is, for levels far below the 100 rem range, we know very little about the risk of radiation-induced cancer. What it boils down to is that we don't know what the risk of cancer from low-level radiation exposure is. What we operate on is a prudent but unproven assumption. The assumption is that this relationship between dose and risk continues down to the lowest dose levels, and risk is not eliminated until the dose is zero. So we strive to keep doses as low as reasonably achievable. The third type of biological effects we should examine are genetic effects, which are abnormalities observed in the offspring due to previous radiation exposure of the parents' reproductive systems. The feeling is that, like cancer induction, there is an increased risk with any exposure, although we've not observed an increase, not even in the survivors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The fourth category of effects is the possible health risks to children of women who are exposed to radiation during pregnancy, prenatal effects. This is an area where we have a great deal of concern for the worker and, in a hospital, for a patient who may be pregnant and who receives radiation exposure. You've seen the signs in the various departments that say, "Let the technologist know if you're pregnant or if you think you might be pregnant." The reason is that we want to carefully control exposure to the fetus. The principal risks to the unborn from exposures during embryonic and fetal stages are childhood cancer, mental retardation, and abnormally small head size. Here are some prenatal risk estimates from the NRC regulatory guide. As you can see, the estimated increase in occurrences is small, comparable to or less than the natural frequency of these effects. And keep in mind, these are calculated values of expected effects for 1,000 millirem of exposure. We've not observed or documented any increases in prenatal effects for exposures within regulatory limits. However, we have a particular concern for the unborn child. During a pregnancy, for the entire 9 months of gestation, we limit the dose to the fetus to not more than 500 millirem for that entire period. So now you know something about the four basic categories of biological effects: prompt, delayed, genetic, and prenatal effects. But the important thing to remember is that while we have established maximum exposure limits to protect us from these effects, a major goal of our radiation protection program is to reduce radiation exposures to as low as reasonably achievable. To make sure working conditions are kept ALARA, every hospital has a radiation protection program, and there are several elements of the program that you should be familiar with. To appreciate what the program's all about, we need to know a little bit about the different sources of ionizing radiation in the hospital. And we might begin that discussion with a look at some things that are not sources of ionizing radiation, which include microwave ovens and X-ray machines when they're turned off. Only when the X-ray is being taken does it become a source of radiation. And patients who receive X-rays are not radioactive. The ionizing radiation passes through their bodies, causes the ion pairs, delivers some dose associated with that procedure, and that's the end of it. When the procedure is over and they leave, they're not a hazard to other people. Indeed, even teletherapy patients, patients who receive very, very large doses of radiation to tumors for cancer treatment, are not radioactive and are not sources of ionizing radiation. The entire nuclear medicine department, the nuclear medicine imaging and counting equipment, are not sources of radiation and are not hazardous to people who work around them. The potential sources of ionizing radiation that we need to be aware of include the X-ray unit when it is turned on, when the beam is being produced, and during that period of time when the X-ray is being taken. The cobalt-60 teletherapy unit used to treat cancer patients is a source of radiation. But unlike the X-ray machine, it can't be turned off, and it's always producing its gamma rays. The method that we use to protect workers is to shield the source when it's not being used so that it's less of a hazard. The radioactive materials used in nuclear medicine that are either injected, inhaled, or ingested by the patient for a particular study, to locate a tumor or to assess some organ function, for example, those radiopharmaceuticals or radioactive drugs are a source of ionizing radiation. And in some laboratories, we use small amounts of radioactive tracers that are also sources of radiation. Additionally, there are two situations where the patient actually does become, in a sense, a radiation source. One such procedure involves the use of radioactive implants, which we call brachytherapy, wherein the radioactive material is placed close to the tumor being treated. If that implant is in the patient for a couple of days, the whole time that the implant is there, that patient is a source of radiation to everyone, including the attending medical staff. And when iodine-131 is used to treat cancer of the thyroid, that patient, while the iodine is in their system, is radioactive. So we need to follow special procedures for both the iodine therapy patient and for the brachytherapy patient while they're hospitalized. Later in the program, we're going to offer specific guidance for individuals regularly involved in iodine and brachytherapy treatments. But for now, let's continue to explore radiation sources in the hospital and how the radiation protection program addresses them. Regardless of which radiation source we're using, there are certain general safety measures in the program which involve the use of time, distance, and shielding to protect against external exposure. If we decrease the time of exposure or the dose rate, then the dose decreases. Dose is equal to the dose rate of radiation that an individual is exposed to times the period of time that the exposure lasts. So the total dose is equal to dose rate times time. This differs from dosage, which is a measure of the activity of a radiopharmaceutical, usually measured in millicuries. There are two primary techniques that we use to decrease dose rate: distance and shielding. This old photograph of an X-ray being taken in 1896 shows how little we knew then about the importance of time, distance, and shielding. The bright object that looks like a light bulb is actually an X-ray tube. And as you can see, everybody in the room is being exposed just to take an X-ray of the patient's arm. Modern X-ray units in hospitals today are a good example of just how far we've come. We limit the operator's time of exposure by having the technician leave the room during the exposure, except in those instances where it's absolutely necessary to hold patients still. We try to maximize the distance between the source and the worker. Exposure decreases rapidly with distance. And the relationship between distance and dose rate follows what we call the inverse square law. Double your distance from a source, and you reduce the exposure rate by a factor of 4, which is 2 squared. That's why we call it the inverse square law. 3 times as far away, only 1/9 the amount of radiation. 4 times as far away, 1/16 the amount of radiation. So distance can be a very powerful tool in radiation protection. And we use adequate shielding to absorb the radiation to prevent it from reaching the worker. With a typical X-ray unit today, you can't see the X-ray tube. It's got too much shielding around it. The X-ray beam is only allowed to come out through the adjustable collimator and is limited to just the portion of the patient's body to be X-rayed. Typical radiation exposures to diagnostic X-ray technicians is fairly low, but it should be pointed out that physicians, nurses, and technologists involved in special procedures like cardiac catheterization work in close proximity to a continually operating X-ray tube. They wear protective aprons and use portable shields that typically reduce exposure levels 30 to 100-fold, depending on the type of protective device used. Since they wear their dosimeters outside of the protective aprons, their recorded occupational doses are usually the highest of all hospital workers. The Radiation Protection Program also specifies techniques for individuals who handle loose radioactive material. Now, by loose radioactive material, we mean radiopharmaceuticals in the nuclear medicine department that are in a liquid or a gaseous form. The objective here is to control the contamination, to follow procedures so that none of that loose material gets tracked around the department or into other areas of the hospital or gets onto the operator's clothes. Again, we'll offer specific reduction measures for these different radiation sources later in the tape. The important point to remember here is that one general safety measure of the radiation protection program is cleanliness. Keeping surfaces and materials free from radioactive contamination is important. Another goal of the program is to prevent misadministrations. We might think of preventing misadministrations as radiation safety for the patient. Now, there are several categories of misadministration. Administration of a radiopharmaceutical or radiation from a sealed source other than the one that was prescribed. Administration to the wrong patient, or administration by a route other than what was intended by the prescribing physician. In radiation therapy, a calculated total treatment dose differing from the final prescribed total treatment dose by more than 10% is a misadministration. In diagnostic studies, it's a misadministration if the dosage of a radiopharmaceutical differs from the prescribed amount by more than 50%. So essentially, we're talking about the wrong patient, the wrong dose, the wrong radiopharmaceutical, or improper route of entry. Another feature of the radiation protection program is the people, and this starts at the management level. Management must make a commitment to keeping radiation exposures ALARA. Now, the Radiation Safety Committee and the Radiation Safety Officer are responsible for making sure that the program is carried out, but the radiation safety program doesn't stop there. Every worker should be aware not only that the program exists, but that each worker has responsibilities to help keep radiation doses as low as reasonably achievable. In addition, every worker should have a basic understanding of the types of radiation being used in that institution. They should also have a feel for what occupational doses they're receiving. As an employee, you can consult with the radiation safety officer, you can review your occupational exposure record, as well as the institution's licensing conditions. So, if you're pregnant, if you suspect that there are any problems, or if you have any questions about your radiation exposure, remember, the RSO is there to serve as that central point of contact between the institution and the individual workers. Okay, another major requirement of a radiation protection program involves the use of personal monitoring devices called dosimeters. You can pretty much tell radiation workers by the badges that they wear. The radiation monitoring device is normally worn for a month, and then it's exchanged for a new one. The badge is processed, and the occupational exposure becomes a part of the individual's record. At the end of each day, it's important that the badge be left at work in a specified location, and it should only be used to monitor your occupational exposure. So don't take it home with you to try to test your home television set or microwave oven. And The monitor should not be worn if at any time you receive medical or dental exposures as a patient. Now, these monitors are fairly fragile and need to be handled with a little bit of care. They're affected by temperature, humidity, and chemicals. So if it falls into your soup, that should be reported to the radiation safety officer. Or if you accidentally run it through the home laundry, and remember, it shouldn't go home with you in the first place, report it to the radiation safety officer before the processing is done. And of course, you shouldn't share a dosimeter with anyone else. So what's the bottom line? The major goals of a radiation protection program are 1, to prevent misadministrations, and 2, to keep the occupational exposures to individual workers, and the collective dose, the sum of all the doses to all the workers in the institution, as low as reasonably achievable. Therapy involves the use of penetrating gamma rays from cobalt-60 or cesium-137 for the treatment of cancer. Teletherapy units are a little like X-ray machines in that they direct a source of penetrating radiation to a portion of the patient's body. But there are some significant differences. First, the amount of radiation that comes from a teletherapy source is by all comparisons massive. An unshielded teletherapy source is no bigger than this plastic pellet, but at arm's length would expose you to the maximum annual occupational exposure limit of 5,000 millirem, that's 5 rem, in just a couple of seconds. And within a matter of minutes, you would receive enough radiation exposure to be lethal. A teletherapy source can't be turned off, so we have to provide large amounts of shielding to protect everyone working in the area. The design of the facility itself has several safety features. Every access to the treatment room must have a door equipped with an interlock system that automatically shuts down the source should the door be opened. It moves the source to its shielded position. In addition, there has to be a beam condition indicator light at all entrances. So even if some malfunction should occur, if the system fails, for example, the beam condition light visually alerts the worker that the source is still in its beam on or unshielded position. And a permanent radiation detector is installed in the teletherapy room and continuously monitors the beam status. Every day, the radiation detector is checked to ensure that it's functioning properly. If it should fail the test, it must be promptly repaired or replaced. But until it's fixed, every time anyone enters the room, they must use a portable radiation survey instrument or an alarming personnel dosimeter to tell them whether the source is in its shielded or safe position. The room is also constructed to allow continuous observation of the patient. This is typically accomplished through closed-circuit television. The mechanism isn't as important as the requirement. The operator outside the room must be able to monitor the patient constantly from the teletherapy unit console. Okay, now there are also various procedures that must be followed. The operators must make sure that the patient is the only one in the room before they turn on the beam. If, at any time, the operators are unable to turn off the beam and there's a patient in the room, that is, someone being treated, if the patient's able to walk, it's just a matter of informing the patient to come out.
Mr. Pearl, we're having some problems with the equipment. Please get up off the table carefully, watch your head, and come out of the room.
Securing the room so that no one else can enter, and then immediately contacting the RSO. The operators should not attempt to retract the source or to fix the unit. That's a potentially dangerous job that requires special training. If the failure occurs when a non-ambulatory patient is in the room, a patient who has to be brought out on a stretcher, the operators must enter the room. The procedure is to avoid the primary beam, close the collimators, or direct the beam away from the patient and the technicians, and remove the patient as quickly as possible. The next step is to secure the room and then contact the RSO immediately. Again, do not attempt to retract the source or repair or fix the problem. It's important to keep in mind that while the radiation level of the primary beam is very, very high, outside of that primary beam, the scattered radiation level is much, much lower, although it would be more than an operator might receive on a routine basis. So it's not a health-threatening situation for the worker. Since teletherapy units contain sealed sources, there's another requirement that has to be met. By sealed source, we mean a source that's encapsulated so the radioactive material itself, say the cobalt-60, can't leak out or flake off from the source and thereby cause contamination. To make sure the source remains fully encapsulated, periodic leak tests must be performed. This is done by reaching up into that shielded head, often with a cotton swab and alcohol, to the vicinity where you would expect the contamination to be if the source were leaking, and then swiping the area. This swipe is counted in a sensitive radiation detector, and the results document that the source is intact. It goes without saying that the beam has to be off during this procedure. Additionally, the teletherapy physicist is required to perform full calibration measurements at least annually. These are designed to ensure that each patient's dose is within that plus or minus 10% that we mentioned for misadministrations. And every month, the staff performs a periodic output spot check of the timer, the accuracy of distance measuring devices, the radiation field light beam localizing device, and the radiation level for one typical set of operating conditions. This spot check is easier and faster than the annual procedure, but if it turns up data indicating that the output differs by more than 5% from the expected values, the therapy physicist would do a full calibration at that point. In addition, a monthly safety check is performed to ensure proper operation of the door interlocks, the beam condition indicator lights, viewing systems, and operation of the treatment room doors. Additionally, there are two types of radiation surveys that have to be performed in the work areas around teletherapy units. One is inside the room with the source beam off. The maximum dose rate, a meter from the source itself, cannot exceed 10 millirem per hour. And the average dose rate around that whole assembly, taken at different locations, cannot exceed 2 millirem per hour. That's all with the beam off, of course. These tests evaluate the radiation field where operators work as they position and move patients during the normal course of events. In addition to protecting the teletherapy staff, these measurements assure us that after hours, when the department's secured and the doors are locked, the radiation levels are ALARA. Yes, there is measurable radiation, but it's extremely low. For other people who come in and out of the department, like maintenance staff, cleaning crews, security guards, their exposure is minimal. The second set of work area measurements is made with the beam on, duplicating the radiation levels that exist outside the room when the room is in use. The purpose of this survey is to measure the radiation level under use conditions at the teletherapy console, at the door, and other teletherapy staff workstations. These measurements are also made in adjacent areas where other people work or are likely to be. This ensures that no additional radiation protection controls are required in those areas. Brachytherapy is another common method of radiation therapy that uses a variety of small, sealed sources of radioactive materials. This technique is different from teletherapy in that we don't place the patient under a radioactive beam, but instead, we put the radioactive source in close proximity to the tumor or the tissue that's being treated. These kinds of treatments are called implants, and there are two types. One type is a temporary implant, wherein the source is placed in close proximity to the tumor for a specified period of time, and then is then removed. A common technique uses cesium-137 to treat cancer of the cervix. The radiation source is placed very close to the cancerous tissue and left there for, say, a period of 2 days. A source holding device, called an afterloading applicator, is precisely positioned in an operating room procedure, and the patient's then taken to her room where the radiation sources will be positioned into the applicator. While the operating room procedure is underway, an authorized source handler loads the individual sources according to the treatment plan and carefully records the number and the activity of the sources being used. During this loading phase, the operator works behind an operator shield. At the beginning of the scheduled treatment time, the source is transported to the patient's room in a shielded cart. The room is private, away from the nursing station and heavy traffic. Now, in terms of our ALARA requirements for the room, the door must be posted with a radioactive material sign, and the visitor restrictions must either be posted on the door or noted in the patient's chart. Before the implant is inserted, the patient should be briefed in a couple of key areas. These would include the nature of the procedure, the importance of staying in bed to prevent the sources from becoming dislodged, the importance of reporting any suspected dislodgement, and the need to comply with all visitor restrictions.
Now, do you have any family or relatives that are going to be visiting with you?
I have two children, 14 and 17. Will they be allowed to visit?
No, no one under the age of 18 is allowed to visit. In addition, if you have any friends or relatives that are pregnant, we ask that they stay out of the room also.
After the sources are in place, a radiation survey must be performed to measure dose rates in millirem per hour at the bedside, at 1 meter from the bedside, and at the visitor line on the floor. And we need to take some survey measurements in the surrounding hallways and rooms to ensure that the radiation level does not require that these spaces be controlled. Now, for the entire period that the sources are in place, the potential hazards are external exposure from the sources in the patient and the possibility of a lost or dislodged source. Since the sources are sealed, there's no radioactive contamination hazard or danger of internal radiation to the workers. Again, we need to rely on time, distance, and shielding to keep radiation exposure to attending medical staff and visitor personnel ALARA. So only those persons needed for medical, safety, or training purposes are allowed in the patient's room during the course of the treatment. Cleaning the room, replacing the light bulbs, and all other non-essential services should be delayed until the sources are removed and the patient is released. The attending nursing staff needs to be briefed on safety procedures. The briefing should cover visitor restrictions, the fact that no visitors who are pregnant should be allowed, that individuals who are under 18 can't be permitted without the permission of the treating physician and the radiation safety officer, and visitors must stand behind the visitor line on the floor. This line is placed as far away from the patient as is practical based on the configuration of the room. Each visitor is also restricted as to the total amount of time that they may visit on any day. To calculate this, we measure the radiation level at the visitor point and then control the amount of time that a visitor may stay in the room based on this measured level. There are also certain restrictions on the nurses themselves. They must comply with the time limit that each nurse may be in the room per day. In addition, the nurses have to wear their radiation monitors while caring for the patient. They leave it at the nursing station at the end of the shift, then use the same monitor on their next shift. And of course, they can't be shared. If additional monitors are needed, call the radiation safety office for extras. There are also restrictions for the patient. In this cancer of the cervix treatment, to prevent potential dislodgement of the source, the patient would be restricted to bed. At any time during the treatment, if a source should become dislodged, the nurse should call the attending physician and the radiation safety officer immediately.
We won't have to do this again, will we?
Well, let's call the radiation department.
In addition, if the patient should die or have to be moved or has a medical emergency, the radiation safety officer should be called immediately. At the end of the prescribed treatment time, the sources are removed from the patient and taken to the radioactive storage area. They're then counted and compared to the log of the sources that were loaded. The idea is to make sure that all the sources have been accounted for. Finally, a radiation survey is made of the patient to make sure that all of the radiation sources have been removed, and only then may the patient be released. Remember that the patient has not been made radioactive by the treatment and is not a source of radiation exposure to others, because this was a temporary implant procedure. By contrast, some brachytherapy patients receive a permanent implant of radioactive material that is put in place and not removed. These permanent implant patients may not be released until the measured dose rate at 1 meter from the patient is less than 5 millirem per hour. And upon release, these patients need to be given some special guidance to help them keep the radiation dose to their household members and to the public, ALARA. Nuclear medicine involves the use of radioactive drugs that are internally administered to patients. These procedures enable physicians to assess the functioning of various organs or to locate tumors and treat disease. Most of the procedures are diagnostic studies and involve the use of very small dosages of these radiopharmaceuticals. This gives the patient a radiation dose comparable to or less than many diagnostic x-ray procedures, even though the radioactive material is injected directly into the patient's bloodstream. In a similar way, radioactive gases or aerosols can be breathed by the patient, and sensitive radiation detectors can show the physician those regions of the lung where air exchange is taking place. Typically, a patient with difficulty in breathing might receive a study like this. From a radiation protection standpoint, nuclear medicine is different from other radiation sources in the hospital in that we're dealing with radiation sources that are unsealed or in bulk form. They're generally a liquid, but are sometimes a gas. With radioactive materials that are loose and unsealed, workers are exposed to the external radiation, the gamma rays coming from the radiopharmaceuticals, and there's the additional possibility that the radioactive material, the drug itself, or traces of it, could accidentally be ingested or inhaled or get into the worker's body through cuts in the skin. And then the worker could be exposed by the radioactive materials inside the body, an internal dose. In terms of risk management procedures in nuclear medicine, let's first examine measures taken to minimize external exposures, and then we'll look at things that need to be done to minimize internal doses. To minimize external exposures, we again need to use time, distance, and shielding. Time of exposure is minimized by proficient, well-trained technicians that can accomplish the various tasks in the minimum amount of time, and that helps keep their radiation doses lower. Distance as a protective mechanism is oftentimes difficult in nuclear medicine because of the very close working proximity with the patients. Workers can't always use remote handling tools. They need to be near the patient to inject the radioactive drug into the vein. Fortunately, many of the radiopharmaceuticals used today give off relatively non-penetrating gamma rays that are easily shielded. In the laboratory, where the radiopharmaceuticals are stored and where individual dosages are prepared and drawn up, lead bricks are used to effectively shield the workers against the external gamma rays from the sources. Also, we're required to keep each vial of radiopharmaceuticals in a vial shield, which is a small metal container typically made of lead. In addition, every syringe that is filled with a patient dosage has to be kept in a syringe shield. That syringe shield can then be placed in a heavier shielded transport container, which provides further protection when carrying the source to the patient. The effectiveness of the syringe shield and the syringe shield container is evident if we set a radiation detector some distance away from a source and then just listen to the response. If we use the syringe shield, there's a marked reduction. But if we go one step further and put the syringe shield inside a transport container, the radiation level drops to essentially background levels, and the response from the instrument drops to practically zero, or to the same level you'd find in the cafeteria. Even right next to the source, where the technician's hands would be, the detector is responding at about background levels. As an overall safety check, daily measurements are made at the end of the workday to determine what external radiation level exists throughout the nuclear medicine department. Measurements are made in all areas where radiopharmaceuticals have been prepared for use, as well as in areas where radiopharmaceuticals are administered. Essentially, we're checking for spills or a source that has not been put away. A weekly external exposure check must also be made in areas where radiopharmaceuticals or radiopharmaceutical wastes are stored. And of course, individual workers receive and wear their personal monitors as they do in other departments. Typically, they're worn on the collar and provide us with a record of what the actual external exposure is for each individual. Since nuclear medicine workers handle radioactive materials on a routine basis, we also have them wear finger exposure monitors to make sure that the radiation exposure levels for the extremities are not exceeded. Finger badges are also worn anytime a worker has to hold a patient during a procedure. The second area of major concern in nuclear medicine has to do with internal exposures, where the radioactive substances themselves can get inside the bodies of the workers. Our objective here is to control radioactive contamination. The basic concept of contamination control isn't new or unique to nuclear medicine. We use it in personal hygiene every day. We rinse off fresh fruits and vegetables before eating them, and we wash our hands before meals. And we've all seen the sign, food handlers must wash their hands before leaving. That's contamination control. The contaminant is chemical or bacterial. But in the nuclear medicine department, it's radioactive contamination. And there is one significant difference. Food service workers have no way of knowing whether the hand washing was enough to ensure that they can pick up your hamburger and not spread any bacterial contamination. After removing their disposable gloves and washing their hands, the nuclear medicine worker can check to see if traces of contamination remain. This hand check is done in the low background area of the clinic, either with a dedicated scintillation crystal or one of the gamma cameras. Other procedures we use for contamination control include no applying cosmetics, no smoking, eating, drinking in areas where these radioactive materials are stored or used. Similarly, foods, drinks, and personal effects should not be left in radioactive material work and storage areas. And laboratory workers need to wear lab coats or some sort of protective clothing in the event some contamination gets on the individual. We try to avoid having to say, sorry, but we're going to have to confiscate your shirt or blouse. So lab coats are important. Wherever radioactive materials are used, the work surfaces are normally covered with absorbent pads. Regardless of how careful we are, when working with liquids, there will be spillage from time to time. The trick is to make sure that any spills that occur on absorbent paper that can easily be disposed of. And the proper handling and storage of radioactive waste is yet another important means of keeping the work environment contamination-free. All of the paraphernalia, the used syringes, swabs, and gauze, the unused radioactive drugs themselves, go into what we call the radioactive waste. We segregate and store these materials in containers that are properly labeled and shielded. For radioactive material with a half-life of less than 65 days, the regulations now permit us to store that radioactive waste for 10 times the half-life of the material and then dispose of it in the ordinary trash. For technetium-99m, with its 6-hour half-life, we need to hold it just 3 days. But iodine-131 wastes need to be held for decay and storage for nearly 3 months. So, depending on the half-life of the material, the length of time we leave it in storage will vary. After the material has been held for 10 half-lives, it's retrieved from the storage area, and all surfaces of the container are monitored to make sure the waste has decayed to levels indistinguishable from our normal background environment. Then the radioactive tags or labels need to be removed so that the tag doesn't mislead anyone and cause the hospital to make the 11 o'clock newscast. Now we can just discard the waste in the ordinary trash. As a follow-up check to make sure that all of our contamination control methods have been effective, a weekly survey is performed in areas where radiopharmaceuticals have been prepared, in areas where they're stored, and in areas where the doses are administered to patients. This survey for removable contamination is done with a swipe. The surfaces are actually rubbed with a swabbing device, and then these swipes are evaluated with a very sensitive radiation detector that can measure down to extremely low levels of contamination. Even packages that contain radioactive materials, we swipe the external surface of those packages to ensure that there's no contamination on them when they arrive. For both the weekly removable contamination check and the daily measurement of the external exposure levels, each hospital establishes a trigger level or a level of concern. Any response greater than that trigger level has to be reported immediately to the radiation safety officer.
We're surveying the area and we have a hot spot. It's higher than the trigger level. We need someone here right away.
In summary, the nuclear medicine worker needs to take protective measures to avoid internal as well as external radiation exposures. The bottom line is that typical radiation doses received by nuclear medicine workers are no higher than many other radiation workers in the hospital. The other major application for nuclear medicine, in addition to diagnostic studies, is the use of radioactive drugs to treat disease. The most common use of radiopharmaceuticals for therapy purposes is the treatment of thyroid disease with iodine-131. The dosage is administered orally, and the quantities are much, much higher than for diagnostic studies because now the purpose is different. The radioiodine will be absorbed by the thyroid tissue, and the intense ionizing radiation will produce the desired effect. The patient who's administered a therapeutic dose of iodine-131 literally becomes a living radiation source. The whole time that that individual has 30 millicuries of iodine in his or her body, that individual must be hospitalized in a private room with a private toilet, more for the control of the radioactive material than clinical management of the patient. The iodine-131 remains within the patient's body for some time. Actually, the excretion functions of the body will be responsible for eliminating most of that radioactive material in a few days. In addition, some elimination takes place through perspiration, wherein small quantities of the iodine will leave the body. This means that things the patient touches, anything that comes in contact with the patient's skin, may become contaminated. Large absorbent pads must be used to cover everything that the patient will be in contact with, the bed, the chair, and the floor around the toilet. Small items that the patient handles, like the TV control and the nurse's call cord, are covered with plastic bags. Some institutions prefer to cover the entire floor surface, and there's a great deal of latitude there. If you look at the requirements and say, what do I have to do? The answer is you have to keep the radiation exposures ALARA, and you have to contain and control and dispose of all radioactive contaminations. Some institutions prefer that the patient not have visitors. Usually, these patients being treated for thyroid disease are otherwise healthy, and not having visitors for 2 days isn't a significant hardship. The door to the room has to be posted with a radioactive material sign, and if visitors are to be permitted, the door should indicate where and how long the visitors may stay. This could also be posted in the patient's chart. No visitors under 18 are permitted, except with the permission of the physician, who is the authorized user, and following consultation with a radiation safety officer. Once the room has been prepared, the patient needs to be briefed on the iodine procedure prior to administration.
Debbie's already told you about what it tastes like and everything?
Yes, she has.
Okay. Do you have any questions?
I don't think so, no.
You signed the permit?
Iodine therapy rooms have a somewhat dubious distinction. The most significant radioactive spill that can occur in a hospital will occur in a setting like this, where the patient's excited and apprehensive, and sometimes, after drinking the material, regurgitates. Unsavory, but it happens, and the result is a lot of loose radioactive contamination. That's one reason why we use all the absorbent pads. The nursing staff has to be aware that if an iodine patient regurgitates, all they need do is cover the spillage so that the contamination doesn't spread and call the radiation safety department. After the dosage is administered, the radiation levels have to be measured at bedside as well as 3 feet from bedside. And if there's going to be a visitor area in the room, a measurement should also be taken there. And measurements should be made outside in the hallway and adjoining rooms to ensure that the radiation level is such that those rooms don't have to be controlled from a radiation safety standpoint. The attending nursing staff must also be briefed on the special restrictions. For example, these types of patients are normally restricted to the room, but not necessarily to bed. If there are provisions for visitors, the visitor time limit should be included in the briefing. In addition, all nurses rendering patient care should wear disposable gloves and wash their hands after caring for the patient. Only disposable table service should be used. And all plates, utensils, linen, bedclothes, and dressings should be placed into specified radioactive waste or storage containers. That means additional disposable gloves and absorbent paper, along with rad waste labels, must be available. There should not be any cleaning of the room or changing of light bulbs or unessential services while the patient's there. Each attending medical staff member has to wear a radiation monitor when caring for the patient. Leave it at the nursing station at the end of the shift and use the same monitor on the next shift. Again, don't share them. Call the radiation safety officer if you need additional monitors. In case of an emergency or any untoward event that might occur, you should call the radiation safety officer and the physician. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission's Reg Guide 8.39 describes when a patient may be released from the hospital and who must be given written instructions for limiting exposure to others. Specific guidance is provided for our iodine-131 patient and for a number of other radioactive materials. However, the patient is still a radiation source upon release and should be provided with guidance on how to keep exposures to other household members and to the general public, ALARA. Those patient guidelines are essentially time, distance, and shielding, and contamination control. The same kinds of measures that we use in the hospital, we'd like the patient to use at home. Keep a safe distance from other family members, launder their clothing separately, and use separate eating utensils. After the patient's released, the radiation safety staff must remove all of the radioactive wastes and perform a survey with swipes to make sure that the room is free of contamination. Finally, the room cannot be reassigned to another patient until released by the radiation safety officer. And everyone who was involved in the preparation and administration of the dose, when the radio item was prepared in the radiopharmacy and when the patient was drinking it, needs to be checked. We use a thyroid uptake probe to measure traces of radioactive iodine that the workers may have been exposed to. We call this kind of measurement of internal contamination a bioassay. Let's see if I can leave you with some perspective about your occupational risk. The average hospital radiation worker in the United States receives about 150 millirem per year. The average person in the United States receives twice that amount from natural background sources. So, occupational exposures in the hospital does represent additional radiation exposure, but it's only half again as much as background radiation. And it's less additional exposure than the average crew member on a commercial airliner receives each year from the additional cosmic ray exposure at high altitudes. So, in spite of its potential risks, working with sources of ionizing radiation in a hospital does not present a significant health hazard. As long as we're careful and follow the proper procedures, we'll continue to have a safe working environment.